Introduction to Geometry, Level 1. Geometry is extremely useful for engineers, architects, painters, carpenters, teachers, electricians, machinists, home builders, and many more. Geometric principles are important in the construction of buildings and roads, the design and use of machinery, the creation of three-dimensional visuals and effects, and to better understand and unlock the secrets of the universe itself. Like any language and mathematics course, the important ideas in geometry must be developed gradually, with understanding, practice, and effort. All right, let's get started with the basics. The simplest figure studied in geometry is called a point. Although a point doesn't have any size, it is often represented by a dot, which does have some size. But keep in mind that for the most part, they do not have a size. We use a dot to visually represent a figure that lacks size. We usually name points by using capital letters. For example, the following 5 points are called point A, point B, point C, point D, and point E. All geometric figures consist of points. Another familiar geometric figure is called a line. Lines are made up of points and are straight. The arrows on the end of the figures show that the line extends infinitely far in both directions. They extend forever and ever. Although a picture of a line has some thickness, the line itself has no measurable thickness, so keep that in mind. Unless it is explicitly stated, lines have no thickness. The following figures are examples of lines. There are 2 different ways we can name lines. The first way is by using a single lowercase letter, such as line M. The alternative way to name lines is by using their points. For example, the line on the right contains the points A and B, so we can call the line AB. Using symbols, we can denote it like this, AB with a line on top, or as follows, line BA. Both ways are acceptable, but for the most part, we denote the letters in alphabetical order, so AB will be the typical way to denote this line. To talk about the next geometric figure, we need to remember a concept learned in Algebra 1. In algebra, you learn that a number line is formed when a numerical value is assigned to each point on a line. For example, the following line represents a number line, and point A is located at negative 1. Likewise, point B is located at 1.5, or written another way, as 1.5. We need to understand number lines in order to understand line segments, or simply, segments. Like lines, segments are made up of points, and are straight. What distinguishes them from lines is the fact that line segments have a definite beginning and end. In other words, they are measurable. They do not extend forever and ever in both directions, like lines do. The following are examples of line segments. The line segment on the left can be denoted as AB or segment BA. Notice that we add a segment on top of the letters in order to distinguish it from that of a line, which contains arrows in both ends. Also notice that a segment is named in terms of its 2 endpoints, because a segment has a definite beginning and end. The figure in the middle contains 2 line segments. The vertical, up and down segment can be called RS or segment SR. Once again, we usually denote them in alphabetical order. The horizontal, crosswise, or from left to right, can be named as segment ST or segment TS. In the following number line, the segment whose endpoint is located at the coordinate of negative 1 and 1 is denoted as line segment BD or segment DB. Likewise, a segment that has a coordinate at negative 2 and 2 is denoted as segment AE or segment EA. So we learn about lines which extend forever and ever in both directions, and we learn about segments which have a definite length and do not go on forever and ever. Is it possible to create a figure that contains both of these characteristics? The answer is yes. These hybrids are called rays. Rays, like lines and segments, are made up of points and are straight. A ray differs from a line or segment in that it begins at an endpoint and then extends infinitely far in one direction only. Lines extend in 2 directions. Rays extend in 1 direction only. So make sure you keep that in mind. The following are examples of rays. Now, when it comes to denoting them, we actually need to be careful and make sure we start denoting a ray by naming its endpoint first. This way, it becomes clear where the ray begins. So the ray on the left is denoted as ray AB. Notice that we add a ray on top going from left to right. This is the appropriate way to denote rays. It would be completely wrong to denote the ray as ray BA. Remember, we want to start with the endpoint first. The ray on the right can be called ray RS or ray RT. As long as the endpoint is given first, any other point on the ray can be used to denote the ray. Now that we know about points, lines, segments, and rays, we can now talk about angles. In essence, an angle is made up of two rays with a common endpoint. This point is called the vertex of the angle. The rays are called sides of the angle. There are various ways that angles can be described and denoted. For example, if we place the number 1 inside the angle near the vertex, like this, we would denote this angle as angle 1. The symbol that we use to denote angles is drawn as follows. It's essentially a picture of an angle. If the angle only contains one letter in the vertex, then you denote it as angle A. When you denote the angle using one letter, make sure you name the point on the vertex. An alternative way is needed if the angle is described in terms of three points. For example, if this angle has a vertex labeled as A, and the other points are B and C respectively, then we need to denote the angle as follows, angle BAC, or angle CAB. Notice that when we use three letters, the vertex, in this case A, must be named in the middle. Make sure you always do this. If we take the same angle and draw another ray from point A to point D, we would end up with three new angles. Make sure you can see them. The first angle is formed by points BAD and is denoted as angle BAD or angle DAB. The second angle is denoted as angle DAC or angle CAD. And the third angle is denoted as angle BAC or angle CAB. Notice that if we try to denote any of the angles by using only one letter, such as angle A, we will be totally confused what angle we are referring to, because all the angles share the same vertex. So in this case, it is really convenient to use three letters to name the angles. Alright, the final figure we will talk about is formed by using three segments, and combining them in the following way. The figure that we just created is called a triangle, and we denote it as follows. Triangle ABC, or triangle ACB, or triangle CBA, or triangle CAB, or triangle BAC, or triangle BCA. Notice that the letters need to start at one point and move either clockwise or counterclockwise when denoting them. The convenient way is once again by using letters that are in alphabetical order whenever possible. So triangle ABC will be the best way to describe this triangle. Notice that a triangle has three segments as its sides. Notice that there seems to be three angles, but they contain no rays. Nevertheless, this figure contains three angles. They are angle A, angle B, and angle C. If you recall from your algebra class, we often talked about sets. Well, it turns out we can think of a triangle as being a union of three segments, and can be denoted using set notation as follows. Triangle ABC is equal to segment AB, union with segment BC, union with segment AC. Likewise, the intersection of any two segments or sides forms the vertex of a triangle, and can be denoted using set notation as follows. Vertex A is equal to segment BA intersected with segment AC. Vertex B is equal to segment AB intersected with segment BC. And vertex C is equal to segment AC intersected with segment CB. Alright, and there you have it. These are the basic building blocks of geometry, and this is only the beginning. To recap, we learned about points, which have no size, but we draw a point to visually represent one. We also learned about lines, which contain points and extend infinitely in both directions. This is represented by the arrows that point in both directions. We also learned about segments, which have a definite length. In other words, they are measurable. As a consequence, they have a beginning and an end, which are called the endpoints of the segment. We also learn about rays, which share the characteristics of a line and a segment. It contains an endpoint in one side and contains an arrow in the other side, which extends infinitely in a direction it is facing. When we have two or more rays that share a common point called a vertex, we form angles. And finally, when we connect three line segments together, forming three distinct vertex, we create a triangle. Okay, make sure you are familiar with all these figures, an appropriate way to denote and name them. In our next video, we will practice denoting and naming figures with various examples.